we begin at the beginning, in your childhood, in your household. Was it a household of intellectual excitement, or were you the outlier?
My father was a school teacher.
Okay.
He taught English language and science. And my mother didn't have much of an education, but she was self-taught. She could read English, and she could read very well. And she taught me how to play chess, and we used to play chess together.
We'll call that the beginning of training. Were they very ambitious for you, or basically did you find your own way without your parents saying, do this, or study here, or go there?
Well, they wanted me to do well in school, and had some ambitions for me, of course, as most parents do. And they expected me to take up some important profession.
Important in the sense of returning money, or important in the sense of achieving something in the world?
Important in the sense of maybe as an administrator in the government, or a doctor, or an engineer, a profession like that.
Right. I would argue a normal profession. A solid profession.
Solid profession.
Okay.
Not end up as a clerk somewhere or something.
Understood. That is like most parents. Okay, so at what point, since we are talking about a whole life in a short time, did you, as a young person, through adolescence, come to have the idea that maybe you were a mathematician? Or
not until quite late.
Ah.
All through school, I wanted to be a doctor.
Yes. Okay. And this is the kind of course study you pursued?
No, it's high school, so it didn't make any difference. Take general. And our medical college had a sort of an open house day for everybody. So we went as a group to the college to see. And they showed us some dead bodies and what they looked like, cut it open, and showed various parts. That was the end. I didn't want to be a doctor anymore.
They often describe certain kinds of academics or lawyers as people who can't stand the sight of blood. So you knew you weren't going to be a doctor. Okay. So were you worried about a choice, or?
No, not really. There was still a senior year in high school. So I went to college. And I had to make a choice at that point.
Exactly.
If I wanted to go to medical school, I would have to take biology.
Right.
So I avoided biology and took math, physics, and chemistry as my subjects.
So it's dramatic to say it, but you sort of stumbled into mathematics. I mean, you took it, but not necessarily as a life career. You just began to take it.
It's junior college, so you had to choose three subjects.
Right, and math
was one of them.
Clearly you had had some ability in science already. You knew that about yourself.
My lab techniques were not great. Theory was fine.
I see.
You know, but anyway, so when I finished my studies at junior college, it was time to apply for a program, which led to a master's. We had a three-year accelerated master's after that. And then I had real choice. I could opt for either chemistry or physics or mathematics or statistics. Mathematics was not really an option.
Really?
Nobody goes for mathematics because it's known that it doesn't provide jobs. So it's very families don't want you to go into mathematics.
I think this is more true in India than in Hungary, where your colleague, Professor Lax, was.
Professionally, I think sciences are considered more useful.
Yes.
Than mathematics.
Practical.
And, you know, you have the option then of maybe going to engineering or doing other things.
So now I see you in the normal progress towards your degree, and eventually you'll pick something. Math is not necessarily where you're going to wind up.
But, you know, I had a math teacher in high school who told me that statistics was an important topic that was new and coming up, and it would be good if I took statistics as an option. So anyway, I applied for math, physics, and statistics as the three options. But the competition is very tough for these 3-year advanced master's programs. And so chemistry, I was denied a seat. The physics people told me that I could get a seat if I promised to take it and not leave and go elsewhere. But then statistics admitted me, so I said, okay, I'll take statistics. So I went into statistics. But statistics is an interesting program because it's part mathematics and part statistics. It has a lot of mathematics in it. And in fact, the math program and the statistics program have overlapped for 50%. They take the same exam, same courses, same classes. And that's in pure mathematics. And whereas the mathematics group take applied mathematics, the statistics group takes statistics instead. So I had a solid background in mathematical training, and I learned statistics. That's where I graduated from college.
I think I'm looking, maybe romantically, for a magical moment when somebody, either you or a professor, begins to see in you the great mathematician you became. And it may not have been a moment. It may have been a year or two. It may have been a few accidental routes. But when is it that we meet the young mathematician?
Okay. After finishing my studies, there are still many options. My parents, of course, would have loved it if I had taken the entrance exam for administrative service in the government. That was an important and well sought after career in India at that time, made popular by the civil service during the British Raj. But I was not old enough to take it, so I could had to wait for 2 years at the minimum age to reach there. So I told my parents that, why don't I try research, see if works out. So I went to Calcutta to the Indian Statistical Institute as a research scholar.
So I'm beginning to feel that this is a bit of an accident in your life. You're too young to progress immediately to the administrative study.
Subconsciously, I was using it as an excuse.
Okay.
Because I wanted to explore research, and my point was, if for some reason research doesn't work out, this was always a backup.
Okay, so maybe when you arrive at the Statistical Institute, because you later become one of the very famous four in this place, so there's some point of, again, it's not ignition, but some point you're there and you're surrounded by brilliant people, I think.
But, you know, my initial choice was to do some applied statistics. Mainly because for some convoluted reason, I thought that applied statistics would get good jobs. So there was still motivation in some sense.
Fair enough.
But I spent a few months trying to read the subject. It left me cold. So I spent my time reading fiction and playing bridge. Then there are some colleagues, fellow research scholars who are doing mathematical studies, you know, are aspects of probability theory that's quite mathematical. And they persuaded me that I was wasting my time and I should start mathematics instead.
And you were persuadable?
Persuadable.
Okay.
That's when I really started learning mathematics modern version of mathematics. Although the college days gave me a strong background, it didn't prepare me for current state of mathematics. So.
Later on in life, you'll be a teacher, and we'll talk about that later, but it seems to me one of the roles of a teacher is to find a talented individual and to tell them that they see this in them. And I'm feeling that the faculty is seeing something in you about where you might make a good contribution.
Well, the faculty at the Statistical Institute was good faculty, but none of them were in mathematics. They were all in statistics.
I see.
So the group in mathematics was mainly the more advanced graduate students who had learned the subject by themselves.
Really?
To work on. And so I joined that group. So we used to organize our own seminars. We would allocate tasks for everybody, and we would go read, come back and report. And then we talked about problems to work on. We came up with the problems and we worked on those problems. So we sort of, the faculty was very encouraging. And he would go and tell them what they are doing, and they'll say, great, that's good, you're doing good work, proceed. But they were not really expert enough in the area to guide us in any way.
So you guided yourself.
We had to guide ourselves.
At what point did you sense this could be a career for you?
I think at some point I had my thesis ready, and I submitted my thesis and defended it and got my degree. And then, you know, there's a difference. You know, you come here from India, and India, you may be one of three or four people doing work in a given area. Here you come and you're amid hundreds, you know.
And so that community becomes critical to your development.
And then as a postdoc, you wonder if you're going to get a tenured position, what your future is going to be. You're not sure, you're not confident enough that you're going to be able to survive.
Before I let you out of India, I bring you here where you test yourself in a way. A famous story is told about you that in your, was it doctoral exams, one of the great Russian mathematicians mm-hmm. was present.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell me a little bit about that? Because somebody must have thought you belonged in this community.
Well, you know, he was a visitor. Kolmogorov was a famous Russian mathematician. And at that time, India had very close ties with the Soviet Union, so we always had a stream of Soviet visitors coming in. And so he came to visit for a month. At that time, I had just finished my thesis, and so they arranged for me to give a talk on my thesis with him in the audience. So I gave my talk, but the talk went on for too long. Instead of an hour, it lasted an hour and 45 minutes or something like that. And people in the audience became restless. And as soon as I finished, they started leaving the room. But the professor Kolmogorov had gotten up to make a comment, and we saw people leaving without waiting for his comment. He got angry, threw the chalk on the floor, and walked out, stomped out, really. So I was quite scared. I thought, you know, that's the end of my PhD. So we ran along with some other graduate students, we ran behind him and profusely apologizing. He said he was not angry at me, because in Russia seminars last much longer, but he was angry at the audience for not waiting to listen to him. So that was it. But he said that he would take the thesis with him to Moscow and then write a report later. And he later wrote a very good report. Mm.
And so before you go to America, which I'll let you go soon to America, but you already have an idea in your head of what you might then pursue?
I wanted to pursue an area called Markov processes, which required understanding of something called differential equations. And the best place for that was NYU. So I was told that I should try to come here.
So you arrive, and what did they do with this strange fellow from India? Do you get assigned a colleague, a mentor?
There was a mentor, Dansker, who was a close friend.
He became a close friend, but you didn't know him at
first. I didn't know him before. Became a close friend. We worked together for a number of years. When I came here, I had an open mind. So the line of work I had done in my thesis was almost at an end. There is no point in continuing on that line. So I had to find a slightly different area to work in. So a problem which Dansker had a student who was working on a problem. He had submitted a thesis and looked at his thesis. It's an interesting problem and he had solved something. Then I looked at the problem and felt that although he has solved it, it could be solved by a different method. And if you did it by a different method, it opened up a whole variety of new problems that can be solved.
And so you took a new approach.
I took that approach, and I found new method for attacking his problem, and it connected with some work the Russians had done. I had not known that they had done it, but it sort of went along at the same time, independently, and in some sense that's the work which later developed and resulted in the Abel Prize.
So dating from that insight, if you will, it's what's become your contribution.
So there's something you hear that just sparks light, and then
You'd run with it.
You run with it for a long time.
You're quite famous for a quote, which maybe was also related to the fact that your wife had an interest in writing and mathematics too, and how that happened, where you say that essentially it's not real mathematics until you can write it down. Now, whether that was an important thing in your own mind to say, but I'm interested in this process where you are taking it outside of thinking, beginning to explain it, and is this a point where you work it out by, if you will, that physical route, that discussion among colleagues and so forth? I'm just interested in the process of how one thinks mathematically.
See, mathematics, as it's written, is very symbolic. So to explain some ideas in words is very complicated. But you can express the same thing in a few symbols very succinctly. And it's independent of language. Whether it's Chinese or French or German or Japanese, symbols are the same.
Yes.
So it helps communication with the with mathematicians who don't speak your language.
How important is it for you, really in political terms, I really mean resource terms, do you find that the committee's established to listen to the work going on and giving support to it and so forth are sufficient to communicate and build a company of mathematicians doing important work? Have you found that to be easy to do? Because you've had administrative, I mean, you were head of this institute for a while too. And so this would be a real question.
I think, you know, until very recently, support for mathematics has mainly come from the federal government. These days, whatever reason, the federal government is not very inclined to support science unless it leads to some tangible benefits in the very short term.
Right.
That's a short-sighted policy because often it takes years, if not decades, before
you can demonstrate some use. How do we look at this question of pure mathematics as opposed to applied mathematics?
I think there are parts of mathematics which are applicable today. There are other parts which may be applicable 20 years from now. Okay. So I think any distinction between pure and applied mathematics is not clear-cut.
I see.
It's a blend.
Do you think, had you not come to the United States, that the kind of thinking, work you would have done had you remained in India would have been different? This has more to do with just resources and circumstances, or maybe even the accidents of life. But when you came here as a postdoc, perhaps you didn't expect to stay here.
Oh, I didn't. I expect to stay for 3-4 years and then go back.
So why didn't you?
Well, various reasons. I liked it here. My wife had just started undergraduate. I wanted to wait till she finished. Then, at that point, I was already at a new track faculty. And I was at a place where I really wanted to be.
Right.
And India didn't have that many places where one could go to. You know, if you're in my area, there is only Calcutta, which is I didn't like the city of Calcutta
anyway,
that much.
It's a real reason to decide where you want to be.
And also the location of the institute in Calcutta is such that it's very difficult to raise children in that area if you're not from that area.
Would a young Indian mathematician now, let us say with something of a parallel, and he's done a postdoc here, would he have better choices
returning
in India?
No, there are better choices. There are a large number of institutions, and the quality of the institutions at the universities have gone up. So there are plenty of choices. No, a lot more people are going back now.
Are considered among your most significant contributions. What have you seen that others had not seen before in terms of a mathematical strategy or theory?
So I think there are sort of three different areas I would say I've made some contribution which has sort of changed the way people look at things. One is description of some random physical systems that change in time. And you can describe them in many ways. These are random things, so there's probability involved, and what you want to calculate are some probabilities. But the specification of the system is through some local parameters. How does it behave locally when it is here? So these are, so somehow from this local behavior, you have to build up the global behavior. And so you have to establish a connection between the two. earlier work involved, and that's one of the reasons I came here, the theory of differential equations to make this connection. Okay. So along with a colleague, Daniel Strook, we discovered a connection which is more probabilistic, more direct connection. And although we use some properties of differential equations and so on, in the end, the connection is stable in its own right, and it's capable of extension to various situations where the classical methods do not apply. So that's used nowadays as one of the standard ways of making this connection.
Help me understand what a new generation of mathematicians has before them. Is it very different from when you were young? Are there different tools? Are there different aspirations? How do we think of mathematics today, the field that the young will face, as being different from your own? Or maybe not different?
In a way, it's hard. It's hard because to do research in a given area, you have to understand what's going on now. But in mathematics, what's going on now is built on what went on before. So you have to understand from day one the subject. So if the subject is relatively new, then you don't have that much to prepare for. But if it's a subject that's been around for a while, then you spend a lot of time learning the subject.
Yes. What about, and I think you were at the first Heidelberg Laureate gathering of young people of talent and probably ambition. What do you think of this kind of these kinds of gatherings? Do they keep the personal in it? Do they expose people to different approaches?
I think young people who are there are happy to meet more senior, well-known people. And some of them have never had the opportunity before, especially if they come from countries outside the Western world. So for them it's really a treat. And it may influence their lives in the sense that that contact may stimulate them.
Is it possible to say that the relationship at graduate level of student and a professor can be collegial rather than hierarchical?
It's hierarchical when you start, but by the time the student finishes, it's more collegial. It's an evolution over a period of 4 or 5 years.
Is there a way to imagine your achievement at this point in your life where mathematics will go as a field, or is it so much a series of accidents and personal quests and so forth that you would not see yourself able to imagine that?
It's very difficult. There are certain unsolved problems in mathematics. There's a list of them. You know, some of them have been solved in recent years. I don't know if you know the story or not. There's one problem which was solved by a Chinese mathematician who really had no tenured position anywhere. He was in some small college in New England, worked on this problem throughout his life and finally solved it. He's the example of somebody sitting in some corner and doing it.
Yes.
But also there are other people, you know, Fermat's last problem, which is Fermat's last theorem, which is a famous problem, was solved some years ago by Andrew Wiles, got Abel this year. And that requires a lot of machinery and a lot of, you know, he was in the milieu of things at Princeton and he solved it. So both kinds.
So there are, is it possible to say that there are an infinite number of problems to be solved?
And you can't predict when they'll be solved. Because, you know, it's like building a structure, solving a problem. If the structure isn't complete, you don't get any credits. And you have the structure more or less complete except for one small piece in one corner. You don't have it. If you have it, you have the structure. But when will you find that piece? Nobody knows.
There's a kind of joy in hearing that you can be obscure in some place without very many resources and so forth and make a contribution larger. It's almost like the situation of the poet. The poet does not need automatically an enormous structure around in order to achieve something remarkable. So mathematics holds that, maybe more than most fields, you know?
It's difficult in an experimental field because to do an experiment you need the group and facilities and infrastructure. All a mathematician needs is paper and pencil and imagination.
And that's as true in 2016 when we're speaking as when you began.
Yeah, that hasn't changed.